we asked that the membership that was interested, and we also asked for the livestock and meat department staff to attend this particular meeting this evening for a very specific reason. We have with us this evening Bill Albanos. He's the executive director of the American Meat Exchange. The American Meat Exchange is an affiliate of the Meat Sheet, which isn't to be compared or confused with the Yellow Sheet or National Provisioner. In fact, Bill, would I be safe in saying that they're competitors? Bill and his company have developed a new method of meat trading that will produce more accurate price information to be fed back to people as Roger Blank, as Steve Bohr, as Gary Ellis, in regards to pricing, negotiating, and so forth for agricultural products. We've recognized, and the industry actually has recognized for quite some time, that the current method of pricing that we have available to us in the meat sheet or the yellow sheet, neither of them are completely adequate as times change, demands change, and they have remained primarily constant. They needed to show more growth and more ability to give the American selling public more of a cross-section in the price structure as it exists. I'm sure you've all seen that, and I'll have my percentages wrong, but only 3 or 4 or 5% of meat traded is quoted. Those figures are quoted on the provisioner. I'm not totally acquainted on how the meat sheet operates, but that isn't adequate. It isn't a fair test of the actual trades that have been made on a daily basis. The program that Bill Albanos has for us today is one that will give us that immediate cross-section. It'll give us that astute information that we must have to enable us to properly price product on a actual existing market rather than inter-industry trades or possibly 2 or 3 loads of a particular product that have only been priced that morning, maybe sold, but at least the intent and purpose of it was to either bear or bull the market. So with no more further introduction, I believe necessary, I want Bill Albanos to take this mic and give us the presentation. I know that it'll be primarily technical. I think that when he's through, you'll find that this is the direction the industry's got to take. It's certainly a direction we're endorsing because we're innovative enough to believe that's the route that must be taken. So Bill, it's a pleasure to have you, and thanks for coming to our convention.
Thank you very much. I want to thank you for inviting me here today, and I will be discussing a very serious subject with you, the price of dressed meat. The price of dressed meat is one of the most important, if not the most important, factor affecting the price that you get for your livestock. Electronic marketing sounds scary and futuristic, but at some point, the future becomes the present. And that is where electronic marketing of dressed meat is at today. I have with me two parts of a presentation. On November 3rd, we, in concurrence with the AMI convention, we had a champagne brunch and had Earl Butts as our guest speaker and invited about 300 industry members. We had a presentation there which, as was mentioned before, was very impressive. We could not bring that whole presentation here because it takes 9 cameras, but what we have is a slimmed down version of that. The words are the same, it's just that it doesn't take 9 cameras to show it. It briefly describes electronic marketing as we envision it. After that is completed, I will then have another slide presentation which will explain in detail how the system is going to work. If we could turn that on now, hope that it works. Yeah, but so that's blocked out. So.
company, and refrigerated railroad cars rush meat deliveries across a continent linked by timber and steel. These trends represented a significant change in the manner of shipping meat, but butchers still selected and bargained face-to-face. Daybreak, 1927. Truck deliveries now offered more flexibility to the meat industry than the railroad. Come to think of it, many things were more flexible in the 20s. Citizens now purchase their meat at self-service counters in stores that were spiraling toward supermarket status. Federal grade standards were now the accepted practice. Carload purchases were made from packers thousands of miles away, but linked by phone in a matter of seconds. For meat was now a commodity that could be sold by description. Thus, the telephone ended face-to-face negotiation. Mass distribution through an advanced communication system was here. Now, let's look at conditions today. The meat industry has become a matter of interest for various parties, and meat pricing mechanisms are one point of this interest. The heart of this mechanism is the tried and true formula pricing system, and this system offers many advantages. But as the industry has evolved, one unfortunate adjunct of the formula pricing mechanism is the advent of a thin market, for only 10 to 30% of meat trades are negotiated, and less than 2% of all trades are actually reported. And thin markets can distort true supply and demand factors. The public, and of even greater consequence to you, the government, have realized this. But so has the industry. And we've also realized we've got to do something about it. More negotiated trades and better reporting techniques will result in more reported prices and a more accurate basis for meat pricing. Information, contemporary, instantly accessible, and comprehensive, is the key to knowledgeable negotiation. To date, quality information and suitable reporting techniques have not been available. But today, a viable, carefully researched alternative is available for your serious consideration. And we're calling it CATS. The American Meat Exchange's computer-assisted trading system. It has been developed for the industry and by the industry without any government subsidy. In short, CATS was developed to let the meat industry improve itself and to keep outsiders out. The General Electric Information Services Company has developed the CATS program for the American Meat Exchange on a nationally respected base of experience in computer marketing technology, supported by more than $200 million in hardware, in addition to an existing international communications network. What can this system do for you? It can receive, process, store, retrieve, and send information at the speed of light and with impeccable accuracy. CATS can be addressed by thousands of buyers and sellers at hundreds of locations, virtually simultaneously. CATS will link regional markets. It will foster efficiency, enhance marketing opportunities, increase information available to traders, and expedite transactions. In addition to these data-oriented benefits, there is another, broader reason why CATS demand your attention. And that reason is that in 1979, the meat industry is using the same pricing system it used in 1927 when truck delivery was a new innovation. Advancements have occurred in other areas of our industry, but the reporting procedures used to establish formula pricing are seriously antiquated. They don't belong in today's marketplace. And the primary reason behind that statement is that the current system actually alters thin markets, which restrict competition. And competition is the cornerstone of a healthy industry. But with CATS, all traders will have access to the same information. Competition will become keener. And then pressures brought to bear by outside interest groups will diminish. For when competition is keen, the public and the government are reassured of an industry's image and sense of fair play. Here's how CATS has been designed to function. Buyers can enter bids, while sellers can enter offerings. Selection then can be based on regions, delivery times, and other criteria. The bids and offers act as invitations to negotiate. Either buyer or seller seeing a suitable offer or bid can negotiate and conclude their transaction through the CATS system. Sellers are identified on all offers, and buyers are identified on all bids. But security and privacy represent one of the system's top priorities. Only price, volume, and time of the actual trade will be reported. Who bought and who sold will not be shown. And the American Meat Exchange will keep CATS responsive to industry needs. CATS also supplies comprehensive, accurate market information. Prices in different sections of the country can be observed while they are being made. Reports of the highest, lowest, last, and weighted average prices for any item, as well as total volume, will be available. The system provides a summary of market transactions by item and at any time by regional and national markets. And of primary importance is the increased opportunity CATS presents for negotiating prices, which in turn affords improved control of your profit margin. And CATS can offer substantial savings in manpower and telephone costs in comparison to conventional one-on-one price negotiations. Of course, CATS needn't be the only matter of trading, but it has the potential of affording an invaluable adjunct to the wholesale meat pricing system. And most important of all, CATS offers a method for the meat industry to improve itself. It will assure the public and the government that the meat industry is sensitive to the demands of today's business climate. All we need to do is sacrifice that which is familiar in order to gain all that is so vital. CATS means control. Control of your market. Control of your image. And control of your business. CATS is the key to the future.
Hundreds of computers linked together around the world that act as if they are one giant computer, and you access it by a local telephone number, and it's the equivalency of having one giant computer system. They have over 5,000 major customers that use that now. They have four or five major computer centers around the world, and this is just a picture of one. This network that they have is international in scope, so it's possible even to trade internationally on such a system, and it's linked together by satellites. This computer power system is operational 24 hours a day. On a meat trading system, I don't think that people will be trading meat 24 hours a day, but the system is there, and as it evolves and matures, new things may be done, and the system is there 24 hours for that. Also, if people are using the system, there's a toll-free 800 number that people could call who might have a problem on the system. The GE provides a 24-hour service for that. How you access the system is through a computer terminal such as this one here. On the CAD system, you have this plus a CRT, which is a television screen. You dial a local number or an 800 watts number so that you're always dealing with a local number. Plug the phone in. You type in your special user number. You hit the return key, and now you're ready to use the American Meat Exchange's CAT system. Now, the first thing to understand about how the system operates is that it's not computerized trading, as some people have said. It's computer assisted. And the difference is that the computer does not actually trade meat. It just gives the information, and the people who are trading meat make those final decisions to actually buy or sell. So all it's doing is assisting the traders. So that's where the word CATS comes from, computer assisted trading system. The next thing to understand is that this is not a price reporting system. Electronic price reporting is something that's been tried many times, and it keeps failing because the garbage in, garbage out concept works. This is a trading system by which the price reporting aspects of the trading is what's reported. If nobody trades here, there is no price reporting. Now, in order to do this, we have to change some of the concepts that are used in the present system. The present system says that there's a national market because the price reporting services only recognize a national market. And really, we don't do that because the trades from the Rockies East is what is the national market. The trades from the Rockies West fall in the garbage can. They don't use them. We've divided the country into 10 sections. And we have selected these sections because we feel that sometimes there are price differences even after you've adjusted for freight. As an example, where the market may be stronger in one part of the country and weaker in another part at the same time. The present system doesn't allow for that. You can't see that. What we'll have is these 10 regional markets, they operate independently and simultaneously from each other. They're accessible, though, by any trader from any region. It allows, as I said, the pricing differences, whereas in the West, pork would be more stronger in the West, at the same time it might be weaker in the East. It also, regional sellers can control where their products are offered so that they don't put an offering into the system and end up with a customer 2,000 miles away that they don't want to deal with. And also buyers control where they put their bids because they can do it by regions. It's their choice. Next thing we're going to do different is that prices will not be on an FOB basis only. The prices will be both on a delivered basis for 9 of the regions and on an FOB basis for the river region. That allows sellers the option to continue offering their product FOB the river like they do now, or offer it delivered to these different regions with the freight included. And the reason the freight is included is so that you can easily interpret what that price means when you look at it. Next problem the present system has, and it's a rather serious one, is that you may have trades of 50, 52, and 54 all going on at the same time for the same product. And the difference mainly is when the meat is being shipped. The present system can't compensate for that, and it causes distortions because the reporters don't know which ones to use. So what we've done is that we've divided the system into 3 time frames. All the product for delivery between 0 and 5 days, we're going to call it the spot market. All the product for delivery between 6 and 10 days, we call it the intermediate market. All the product for over 10 days delivery, we're going to call the future market. Not to be confused with the Chicago Mercantile Exchange futures, this is cash we're talking about. In order that people can understand the products we're talking about here and computers can understand it, we've taken the NAMP Meat Buyer's Guide numbering system and or IMS, which are one of the same, and use those numbers. We've done a couple other things. We've recognized that there's such things as premium type pork and standard type pork, and we've addressed that by defining them differently. The items that we're going to trade on here, I want to be sure that you know that we're not talking about livestock at this stage here. We're only talking about the items that appear in price reports. In the case of beef, we're talking about carcasses, primal cuts, cows, carcasses, trimmings, box beef. In the case of pork, we're talking about hams, belly, saucer materials, loins, and butts. This is an example of what the product numbering system looks like. It looks a little complicated, but it's not. For instance, MT stands for meat type, 402 stands for ham, and 14/D is the weight range. And this is not a brand new numbering system, so the people in the industry have been seeing these numbers and they use them in boxed beef. So it's not a whole new education they have to have for these numbers. The first one there, 158, stands for rounds, and by using S and a 7090, we can describe a steer round in numbers so that both computers and people can understand. The next thing is electronic marketing system that you've heard about before for eggs, for stocks, for cotton, are basically a blind matching of buyers and sellers. That means that if somebody puts in a bid of 50 cents, and somebody puts in an offering of 50 cents, the system automatically matches them up, consummates a transaction, confirmation is typed, and they have a transaction. They don't know who they're dealing with until after the deal is made. Well, that's not acceptable to the meat industry. So what we've done is slow that whole process down. And the first thing we have to do is to identify who the participants are. And we're taking the USDA establishment numbers, and people will be shown on the system by either their USDA establishment number or their name, whichever is their choice. This also allows people to know in advance what plant the meat is coming from when they're looking at an offering. This is just to show that the government has about 7,000 numbers. Almost everybody that's in the meat trading business has a number. Now to recap the structure of this again, we have 10 regional markets that operate independently but simultaneously. 9 of them are on a delivered basis. 1 is still on an FOB basis. We have 3 time frames. We have a standard product terminology. And we have identification of all participants down to their plants. First thing in an electronic marketing system is the bids and offers. What you'll see in the bids and offers is the identity of the offer bidder, the product being offered, the quantity being offered, the delivery date, and the time this bid and offer was put into the system. It's a piece of market intelligence so that you can tell if this bid or offer is 5 minutes old or 5 hours old. You might say in a national system there would be thousands of bids and offers for all these products, and it would be a tremendous job searching to find them. But our system is a selection system. You select it by the region you're interested in, the time frame you're interested in, and the product you're interested in. And the system automatically, within seconds, finds whatever bids or offers you're looking for after you've told it what you want. This is a typical format of what an offer would look like. You see here the trader has selected offerings for the Chicago region, for the spot market, for S100Y367s, which is steer carcasses, yield 3, 600, 700 pounds. The first column is the region, Chicago, the time frame, the spot, that means all of this is for 0 to 5 day delivery. The item, the quantity being offered, the delivery date, the price, whose offerings it is by the USDA establishment number, and the time and sequence number. The time and sequence number serves two purposes. One is that it's the first four numbers are 24-hour clock, and the system automatically assigns it the time it was put in the system. The rest of the number, I'll explain later, identifies this offering separate than any other one in the system. The format of bids, which is the reverse, is the same thing. Here the trader is asked to see bids for the Chicago region for heifer carcasses, H100Y3, 500, 700 pounds. You notice in the second column, the trader didn't ask for a time frame, so it gave him whatever it had. In this case, it had both bids in spot market and the intermediate market. Otherwise, the format is the same as offerings. The source IDs is the name. Some people use their name, and some people use their plants, their choice. If they want people to know what plant it's coming from, they'll put it on there. And again, the time and sequence number. And again, the first numbers are the 24-hour clock. It tells the traders how old this system is, how old this bid is, and the rest of it identifies it separately. Now, how do buyers and sellers trade on this system? It's possible for a seller to put an offering out on the screen in the morning what he wants to sell. He can put out he wants to sell 5 loads or 100 loads, it's his choice. At the same time, a buyer comes to the system and puts on there what he's looking to buy. He can put out there he wants to buy 5 loads or 100 loads. What happens is that it's also possible for an offerer never to put an offering out, but just to respond to somebody's bid, who put one in the system, or vice versa, that a buyer could just respond to an offering. He never has to put his own bid out. Of course, if nobody puts any bids or offers out, the system will be blank. And what they do to respond is they type that time and sequence number into the system, the one that they want to respond to. And they go into what we call the private negotiation mode. Now this is on the system, but off all the public screens, because so far on the public screens are all the bids that are public and all the offerings that are public. This activity that's going to occur in this private negotiation is only between the parties that are negotiating. It follows the traditional way that people are doing business. They don't want anybody to know who they're doing business with. The only thing that becomes public out of this negotiation mode is the quality that was bought, the price, and the time. The system has flexibility from the standpoint that we are developing prices for commodities of each of these items. We are identifying what the premium discount is between the buyer and seller and separating it from the price. So that prices are reported without the premiums and discounts so that everybody can evaluate it and they can all be put together so you can interpret them. We're told that every buyer and every seller has different kind of meat, that there's just hundreds of different types of trim, and all of those facts are true. But we've narrowed it down that there are really 9 reasons for a premium or a discount, and all the parties have to do is to put a value as to what that premium might be for whatever extra service they're asking for. In the case of chain stores, they may have store door delivery. So they would say, we want to buy it for $1 a pound, but we'll pay an extra $1.50 premium for store door delivery. Well, the $1 a pound is what gets mixed into the price reporting aspects. The store door delivery premium money is not part of that. Same thing goes for grade selection or special trim or net weight receiving or these other items here. If you notice, the last one is a premium discount for freight. We recognize that one number will not fit all the regions, so there may be a 0.25% or 0.5% premium or discount that somebody would want because of where they're located in the region, as we've described it. Give you an example of what I mean. Is let's say Safeway is buying carcasses delivered to the West Coast. They want to pay $1.15, but they only want to deliver to Salt Lake City, which is $1 less. So they would be asking for a penny a pound discount in this item, even though the trade would be $1.15, they'd actually only be paying $1.14. But the bids and offers, as I said, are seen on all the public screens. These are the type of companies that would be trading with each other that would see these. In the private negotiation mode, only the people that are negotiating see that activity. The only activity that becomes public is the price, volume, and time. Nobody knows who bought from who, and nobody knows who sold to who. Now, the market information that's generated by this trading is what we're really trying to get to. This market information has the volume traded through the last sale. That means as hundreds of negotiations are being consummated, the system automatically updates them instantaneously, keeps adding to the volume. You see the highest, the lowest, the last, and this is truly the last price because the system controls when the trades occur. It knows when they've occurred, so they know truthfully which is the last trade, and the weighted average. And again, it's a selection system by region, time frame, and product. And we have a new category here called type of transaction, because in the market information, it does one more thing. It separates all the slaughterer-to-slaughterer transactions from slaughterer-to-non-slaughterer transactions. It reports them all, it just separates them into 2 separate groups. This is what the format might look like for a summary. Here the trader is asked to see the Chicago region for the slaughterer-to-processor, which is the same thing as slaughterer-to-non-slaughterer. For steer carcasses, you see the region, the time frame, the item, the volume, 1,080,000 pounds of carcasses are traded so far today, the highest price, the lowest price, the last price, and the weighted average. Now, all this market information is designed to help people negotiate. In order for them to negotiate, they have to know as much as they can about what's happening in the marketplace. That's what this is for. And then they look at that and say, well, 1,080,000 pounds have traded, but I wonder when it was done, or was there a lot of people involved? Was it one big trader, or what may happen, so we can go and ask for detail. In the detail, we see the time each transaction occurred, the volume of each transaction, the price of each transaction. And again, it's a selection system by the same criteria. Here we see the format of transaction listing for the Chicago region for the spot market for steer carcasses. If you notice in the fifth column, it's the time that each transaction occurred. The next column is the volume of each transaction, and the next column is the price of each transaction. So that if it was 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you know that nothing's traded since 11:15. Now that's a piece of market intelligence. If you add up the volume, it comes to 1,080,000 pounds, so that any summary that you see in the system, you can always get the detail of it. You also notice it does not show who the buyer or who the seller is. Nobody knows who buys and who sells. Now this market summary information and detail is what everybody's interested in. Now we anticipate that maybe 300 to 1,000 major buyers and sellers will trade on the system. The other 9,000 people that use the information are only interested in the byproduct information. How would they get that? Obviously, if you're a trader on the system with a terminal, you would have access to it. You can have less sophisticated terminals, run as low as $50, $60 a month, and you can access the system to get the information. The General Electric network can be accessed even by a touch-tone telephone. You get a computer-generated voice response to get a piece of market information. The meat sheet will publish the market summaries, so that at some point in time, the meat sheet would be nothing more than the printed version of what's happening on a computer. So that for as little as a subscription to the meat sheet, which is what people have now, you could get the information from the computer, just can't get it as fast. Lease wire services like LFM or some of the other distribution systems would also be carrying this. But the point is this, that not only the traders will have the information, but everybody in the marketplace has access to it. Whichever, the higher price you pay, the faster that you get it. The whole purpose here is to encourage price negotiation, as you saw in our other presentation. Thin markets or a small amount of negotiated trading is what the problem is. People tell us that they want to trade more, but they don't have enough information, so they just deal on a formula and they don't have any problem. But when everybody's doing that, you have the problem that we're faced with today. So this system is designed to give them the types of information that they are able to feel comfortable coming up with a price. Because not only does the seller have to be able to come up with a price, the buyer also has to feel comfortable. And so he has to have the same information and be comfortable with the number before he agrees to pay a negotiated price for 5 days from now or 10 days from now. This system eliminates subjective pricing. I keep saying that it's untouched by human hands. The present system of price reporting, the reporters take the trades, they have to adjust for freight. They throw some of them away. They don't know what to do with some of them. It's a lot of subjective analysis goes into the present system. This system here is designed that every trade that goes on the system is part of it. The American Meat Exchange does not touch the trades, adjust them, or do anything. They just are a pure product of the trading, which is what price reporting is supposed to be. And also, nobody will be trading off the system and feeding those trades into it. The only trades that will be reported on the American Meat Exchange are those trades that are actually consummated through the network. Will not be feeding trades somewhere else. Doesn't mean that they won't trade somewhere else, but those trades will not be part of the market, of this market. This guarantees the integrity of the prices. The benefits of such a system, it benefits the market confusion. Right now, people are trying to make decisions to buy or sell based on rumors that they heard 3 loads may have sold for this price, or 2 loads may have sold, or the buyer or seller says, I just bought 10 loads at this price, you better take it or leave it. Here, people actually will see the market as it's occurring, because you can see the information and react quickly to it. Chain stores and packers both tell us that if they could negotiate and knew what price they could sell their meat for 10 days from now, or chain stores, if they knew what they were going to pay for the meat 10 days from now, they'd be able to do a better job of merchandising, and the packer side, better job of organizing. It's possible that if prices do come up for a 10-day market, livestock producers may be willing to sell at a certain price based on that. So that they'll have a tendency to take the 4 or 5 cent drops out of the market that we see once in a while here, that we don't know why they occur. If you're going to do more negotiating, and there are such things floating around as potential legislation that bans formula trading, which would cause chaos in the industry because they're not prepared to do all the negotiating that would have to be done. So such a system as this would have to be developed to do it efficiently. If they tried to do more negotiating without any new system such as this, they'd have to hire a lot more people and have a lot more phones, and it would cost a lot more money to do it. And again, the information on this system is available to everybody, not just the people who trade on here. And I want to say again that this is a trading system. I know you hear about it as electronic pricing. It's an electronic trading system. It's a marketing tool of which people will buy and sell dressed meat products. So the price reporting is only the byproduct. If we could turn on the lights. You might ask, well, where are we at with this system now? We have presented this presentation to 18 or 20 of the major buyers and sellers of meat in the country. We are prepared at this moment to start a system. We have a system built and are only waiting for these 20 people to agree to participate. We have about 6 or 7 of them that have agreed. The other people are still considering it. Most of the people, as a matter of fact, all the people are positive. They just vary from which stage of positive they are. We think that we will be able to start about March 1st to get these 20 major people to deal on this system. Now, most of the people we're talking about are major buyers that are not part of the present system. Right now, trades that go to stores like Safeway or Jewel's or Kroger's or Winn-Dixie's never become part of this market, the present system, because their trades are not reported. So this would be a whole new world to include those trades that are occurring through chain stores to be part of the marketplace like they really should be. Also, there are other electronic marketing systems that you've heard about for livestock, and I'd be glad to add, maybe I should just recap for you for a second, that the government has funded a couple of other projects. Ours is not government funded because we didn't want it to be. We felt that the industry should build the system themselves and operate it themselves and not have government involvement, because it would be a very chaotic situation, I think, if the government became involved in building and operating such a system as this. But they've given grants for testing this concept for live hogs in Ohio, cull cows in Virginia, eggs in Georgia, and feeder cattle in Texas. Now, the stage of development that they're all at is that they're still developing their systems. I think that we are the furthest along, and that we are actually prepared to start operating the minute that the 20 people give us the okay. And I'm prepared to answer any questions you may have. Yes, sir.
What safeguards do you have for that?
Well, let me say this to you. The present system is what I call a formula trading intense marketplace. That's where 2 or 3 trades are setting the price a lot of the times. So there's a lot of reasons why there's an incentive for the type of activity to happen that you just talked about. In this kind of a system where we're trying to get 100 to 200 to 300 loads of meat to establish the market, the incentive for a hokey trade becomes lost. And what we're trying to do here is we're trying to voluntarily change the system. We're trying to voluntarily take the incentive out for the kinds of things that are being alleged. Now, nobody knows if those things happen and don't happen. But in a system where 300 trades set the price, a phony 2 or 3 trades would be lost, would be meaningless. So there's no incentive to do it. I'm not saying from the first day we start that way, but eventually this is where we're trying to get to. I can do that with a job. Yes? I can't hear you, sir. Well, this is for you only from the standpoint as what dressed meat prices relate to your livestock. You can take the dressed meat prices from here, just like you take them from the present system, and evaluate what the livestock price should be. Well, it's not the Board of Trade, because we're not trading livestock here. We're trading, for instance, in beef carcasses. Right now, the present system looks at what the dressed meat price for beef carcasses is, and they apply a formula, and they generally get an idea of what they sell the cattle for. This is just another more competitive way of establishing the price for the carcasses, if that's what the item we're looking at here. That's how it relates to producers. Yes, sir?
To what extent does an offer put on that screen and our plan at all?
Not at all. We anticipate that the offerings and bids are really invitations to negotiate as a place to start the negotiation. We don't feel there's any relationship to people. They put offerings out. Nobody ever offers exactly what they want to sell it for. Nobody bids exactly what they want to pay it for. So that all they are is a place to start off in the morning for people to get together on a private negotiation and start the transactions.
Are they going to be bargaining in good faith?
Well, in this case here, this transaction is set by both the buyers and the sellers. They both have to agree to the trade. Now, I know that that's basically the safeguard. In the present system, some people feel that it's not really a safeguard, but it really is when you're away from formula trading, only three transactions set the price. 100 transactions set the price, if there's a Hokie one, it'll get mixed in and get lost. There won't be Hokie ones because there's no reason to do it. Yes, sir? Oh, always is. It's a free enterprise system. Well, let me go. There are three parts to the cost of how the system operates. The first part is a one-time initiation fee that's paid by anybody that wants to participate in the system. It ranges from $500, a one-time charge, and that's for a company that has $1 million sales, to $10,000 for a company that has $2 billion in sales. And all the ground in between. That's a one-time charge, just once. The second charge is the rental of the terminal, which will run about $250 a month to rent the terminal, a trading-type terminal. Then there's a time charge for while you're on the system. It's similar to what you pay when you pick up the phone, you talk for 2 minutes, you get a two-minute call. This system is designed to measure how long you're on there. You turn it on and use it for 2 minutes and then turn it off, it charges you for 2 minutes. We estimate that the time charge would be about $25 to $40 an hour that you would be on the system. It's like if you pick up the phone and talk for 1 hour. Same thing here. Turn it on for 1 hour straight, which nobody will. Because it's a selection system, you turn it on, ask it a question, then turn it off, and then wait 15 minutes before you ask it the next question. It's not the type of thing that stays turned on and prices just keep flashing by like the ticker tape does. So those are the three parts of the cost: initiation fee, renting the terminal, and the time you're on the system. Yes? Yes, the General Electric network can be accessed by a touchtone telephone. Whereas you couldn't be designed, and any telephone could be a touchstone telephone. So in that case, you would be, that's not ready to start right now, but eventually we'll come to that. But you can access it now through simple $50 a month terminals if you just want to get the information. Yeah, yes?
How does this information get back to small farmers then? And nobody in Hempfield can afford that. Or they still don't know.
Well, maybe you get together as a group and be part of the system to get the information.
I don't think you get together as a group.
Well, whatever, this is how you'd have to get it one way or another. You could buy a subscription to it for $250 a year. That's